لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
باب من كره للعائد أن ينظر إلى الخبور من البيت. حدثنا علي بن حجر قال أخبرنا علي بن مسهر عن الأجلح عن عبد الله بن أبي عدي قال أخبرنا عبد الله مسؤول على غريب يقوله ومعه قوم وفي البيت امرأة فجعل رجل من القوم ينظر إلى المرأة فقال له عبد الله لو انفطرت عينك كان خيرا لك.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue with the kitab الأدب المفرد by Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى. And we are currently going through the chapters pertaining to visiting the sick. So Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى begins the chapter 244 باب من كره للعائد أن ينظر إلى الفضول من البيت. The chapter of that it is prohibited for the one who visits the sick to look at other than the things that he is allowed to in the person's house. So he mentions this etiquette, and this is a very important etiquette for the believers to learn and understand. He mentions the hadith, which is hadith number 531. He says, "An Abdullah ibn Abi al-Hudayl qala, dakhala Abdullah ibn Mas'ud ala mariidin ya'uduhu." But Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he entered upon someone sick that he was visiting. وَمَعَهُ قَوْمٌ And with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu an were his people. There were a group of people with him. وَفِي الْبَيْتِ امْرَأَةٌ And in the house there was a woman, she was working in the house. فَجَعَلَ رَجُلٌ مِّنَ الْقَوْمِ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى الْمَرْأَةِ So a person from the people that was in the gathering was looking at the woman that was there. And it was said that the woman was behind the veil, or she was behind somewhere, and there was a gap that they could look through, and they were able to see her there. فقال له عبد الله so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud he said to him لو انفقأت عينك كان خيرا لك if your eye was taken out or if your eye was lost then this would have been better for you. So in this chapter Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala mentions this great etiquette of a believer that he only looks at that which is permissible for him to look at. And if he goes to visit someone's house, whether it is to visit him or visit the sick or whether it is just to visit his friend or he's invited over or he's a guest there, it is not permissible for him to look at anything the head of the household would not want him to look at. Whether it be something halal for him to look at or not, it is not permissible for him to look at something the head of the household would not like him to look at. So for example, in this instance, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that this person was looking at a woman who was in the house. There is no doubt that the head of the household would not allow him to look at her. And nor is it permissible for him to look at a woman who is not wearing a hijab, or a woman who is not covered, or a woman who is not lawful for him to look at. So he was looking at this person, so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, it would be better for you if your eye was taken out. Or it would be better for you if you had lost your eye, because you are using your eye now, which is a blessing from Allah Jalla wa'ala, you are using this to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. And there is a similar narration that we find in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنِ اطَّلَعَ فِي بَيْتِ قَوْمٍ بِغَيْرِ إِذْنِهِمْ Whoever looks into a house of someone without his permission, فَقَدْ حَلَّ لَهُمْ أَنْ يَفْقَأُوا عَيْنَهُ It becomes permissible for them to take out his eye. And another hadith in the Sahih, the Prophet ﷺ mentions that if he was to have a stone, and if someone was to look in a gap or a crack that looks into your house, and he were to get a stone or a spear and plunge his eye out with it, then there is no harm in you for doing this. To show how severe this matter is in the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For a person not to look into the private places of people, not to look into their homes, not to look into the things that are not lawful for them to see. And similar to this is an adab that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also mentions, that will come later on in this kitab. But if you go to visit someone's house and you knock on their door, it is not permissible for you to stand in front of the door. Because when they open the door, you will be able to see everything that is in the house. So if you knock on their door, you stand on the side. So if they were to open their door, then you are not able to see what is inside their house. Because there could be someone from his family walking at the back. Or there could be something that they do not want you to see that is in their house. So it's not permissible for you to stand in front of the door and knock, so when they open the door you can see inside. And this is for anything that allows you to see inside a person's house or inside a place where a person does not want you to look at. And this is a very important etiquette of the believer. Sometimes we find that maybe a guest is invited to someone's house. So he's sitting in the room. And then the person, he goes maybe to go to get him something so he can serve him. When he's gone, he's looking everywhere in the room. Maybe he even stands up, he opens the drawer, he looks at certain things. This is not permissible for a person to do. And this is what is intended by this hadith. Not just limiting it to looking at a woman who is in the house. That's why Imam al-Bukhari, he says, بَابُ مَنْ كَرِهَ لِلْعَائِدْ أَنْ يَنْظُرَ إِلَى الْفُضُولِ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. That which is prohibited upon a person who is visiting to look at anything surplus in the house. Anything more than what he has come for. Anything more than what the head of the household would permit him to look at. So this is a very important etiquette of the believer. This hadith also shows you the importance of the eye, which is a ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. The importance of the eyes. That if these eyes are used for haram, it is better that we do not have them. Because we are going to be accountable and we are going to be questioned for every single thing that we look at. And that's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, it would be better for you if your eye was lost. If your eye had been taken out or it had been lost. If you were blind. Because then you will not be able to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your eyes. And this is something that we should all ask ourselves. Do we obey Allah Jalla wa Ala more with our eyes or do we disobey Him more subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are our eyes something that will take us to Jannah or are they going to take us to Jahannam and bring us the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? All of us, we know our sins and we know the crimes that we commit and we know when we lower our gazes and when we don't. So this is a hadith and this is a reminder to all of us that is it better for us to have our eyes or not? Because our eyes could testify against us on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, and it could be because of them that we go into Jahannam. Our eyes could testify against us on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, and it is because of our eyes that maybe Allah Jalla wa Ala will be so angry with us that He will punish us a severe punishment. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, we ask for His protection. So this hadith shows us that a believer is not allowed to look at anything which is unlawful for him to look at. It may be haram in the Sharia for him to look at, and then it is clear he's not allowed to look at this. Or it may belong to someone else, and that person does not want you to look at it, and therefore it becomes impermissible for you to look at it. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى باب العيادة من الرمد. حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مبارك قال حدثنا سعد بن قتيبة قال حدثنا يونس بن أبي إسحاق عن أبي إسحاق قال سمعت زيد بن أرقم يقول رمدت عيني فعادني النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم ثم قال يا زيد لو أن عينك لما بها كيف كنت تصنع؟ قال كنت أصبر وأحتسب. قال لو أن عينك لما بها ثم صبرت واحتسبت كان ثوابك الجنة.
Now Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى begins the chapter باب العيادة من الرمد. The chapter of visiting someone who has inflammation on his eyes. The chapter of visiting someone whose eyes are swollen. Or he has inflammation on his eyes. Now why is Imam al-Bukhari mentioned this specific chapter? The reason why he has chosen this is to show that when we visit people, it's not only for major illnesses. But a person could have a very light illness. Or a person could be suffering from something very small. But the fact that he is suffering from something now gives him the right to be visited. And it also allows the visitor to earn reward in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by fulfilling the rights of this believer. So it is not just life-threatening conditions that call for a person to visit someone else. But it could be anything that is harming him, anything that could be upsetting him. It could be a physical illness, it could be a mental or emotional illness. It could be something that he is suffering from, some type of pain or depression or sadness. And all of these things are illnesses that a believer should go and visit another believer because of. So Imam al-Bukhari mentioned this chapter not just to limit it to someone who has inflammation on his eyes. But for anyone who has any type of illness or any type of discomfort, it becomes sunnah for a person to visit him. So he mentions the hadith of Abi Ishaq. He said, سَمِعْتُ زَيْدِ بْنِ أَرْقَمْ يَقُولُ. That I heard Zayd ibn Arqam say, رَمِدَتْ عَيْنِي. That my eyes, they swell up. فعادني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم visited me. ثم قال يا زيد. He said, oh Zayd, لو أن عينك لما بها كيف كنت تصنع. He said, oh Zayd, if your eyes were taken away from you, what would you do? And this is a very good question, because it makes a person reflect on the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one way that maybe if a person visits someone who is suffering from maybe an illness in their hands or in their legs or in their eyes, then if this was removed from you, how would you feel? When you know inshallah ta'ala it's not going to go from him. So then he will appreciate these blessings that he has. Because when a person loses something which is a blessing from Allah Jalla wa Ala, this is the only time he truly appreciates the blessings. We have thousands and thousands of blessings that we do not know are blessings. But if they were ever taken away from us, then we will begin to miss them and we will remember them as blessings. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, if your eyes were taken away from you, how would you feel? So he said, قُنْتُ أَصْبِرْ وَأَحْتَسِبْ. If they were taken away from me, then I would remain patient. And I would try and seek the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how the Sahaba were. That they know that every calamity, every trial, everything that is going to afflict them, it is only going to be in this temporary life. And this temporary life is going to come to an end one day. So every illness will come to an end one day. And the only thing that will remain is the Akhirah. Whether the person will be in Jannah, in a perfect state for eternity, or a person will be in Jahannam, in complete punishment for eternity, only the Akhirah will remain. So he said, if I were to lose my eyes, then I would remain patient, and I would seek the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَوْ أَنَّ عَيْنَكَ لَمَّا بِهَا ثُمَّ صَبَرْتَ وَاحْتَسَبْتَ كَانَ ثَوَابُكَ الْجَنَّةِ. If your eyes were taken away from you, and then you remain patient, and you sought the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your reward would be Jannah. Your reward would be Jannah. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the reward for being patient, for losing someone's eyes would be Jannah, this shows you how great a blessing the eye is. It shows you how great a blessing our eyes are. Because if losing them and we are patient is enough for us to enter Jannah, then imagine how great these blessings are of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So what is the crime of the person that has never thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing of the eyes? Is this a severe crime? Of course it's a crime. Because if losing this and being patient because you have lost it is such a great reward for you to enter Jannah, it shows you how great a blessing these eyes are. So thanking Allah Jalla wa Ala for these eyes is obligatory upon all of us. And acknowledging that these eyes are great blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is obligatory upon all of us. And using these eyes to please Allah Jalla wa Ala is obligatory upon all of us. Using these eyes to please Allah Jalla wa Ala is obligatory upon all of us. So from this hadith we find many benefits, and from amongst them that a person should visit his companion, a person should visit his friend, a person should visit a believer even if he has a small illness. And a person should remind him of the blessings that he has. And a person should remain patient if he's ever afflicted with any harm or calamity. And if he remains patient and looks for the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his reward will be Jannah. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا موسى قال حدثنا حماد عن علي بن زيد عن القاسم بن محمد ان رجلا من اصحاب محمد ذهب بصر فعادوه فقال كنت اريدهما لانظر بهما الى النبي صلى الله عليه واله وسلم اما اذ قبض النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فوالله ما يسرني ان ما بهما بربي من غباء التباله.
Now the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions the hadith of Al-Qasim bin Muhammad. أن رجلا من أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ذهب بصره فعادوه. That there was a companion, a man from the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he lost his sight. فعادوه, so the people they visited him. فقال, so he said, كنت أريدهما لأنظر بهما إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. I only wanted my eyes so I could see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with them. And it shows you the love that the Sahaba had for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That just by looking at them, just by looking at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would increase in their iman. Because they would see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and it would remind them of perfect character. It would remind them of the etiquettes of the Quran. It would remind them of ibadah, and it would remind them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just by seeing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they would increase in their iman and they would be more devout worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he lost his eyes and they visited him, he said, I only needed these eyes to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. فَأَمَّا إِذَا قُبِدَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَوَاللَّهِ. He said, now that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has gone, so by Allah, مَا يَسُرُّنِي أَنَّمَا بِهِمَا بِضَبْيٍ مِّنْ ضِبَاءِ تَبَالَ. It wouldn't delight me if I was to see a deer from the deers of Tabala, which is a place in Yemen, meaning a place that people would go and they would see this and for amusement and entertainment. He said, like, I wouldn't find entertainment enjoying anything. So now that the Prophet ﷺ has gone, there is no harm in my eyes going because I do not need them anymore. Now this narration that is mentioned by Imam al-Bukhari has Ali ibn Zayd in the chain. And for this reason, the narration is da'if. But there is no doubt that the companions of the Prophet ﷺ used to find delight and joy in looking at the Prophet ﷺ. Like you look at some of the Sahaba and they would say, when we saw his face, we would think that it was the moon. Or it was a piece of the moon. That it would shine with light. And they used to be so happy when they used to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Father rahmatullahi ta'ala, haddathana Abdullah ibn Salih, ibn Yusuf, qala haddathana Layth, qala haddathani Yazid ibn al-Had, an Amr Mawla ibn Qalib, an Anas qala sami'tu Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, qala Allahu azza wa jal, idha ibtalaytuhu bi habibatayn,
now the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions the hadith which is in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari on the authority of Anas radiyallahu anhu said, سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say, قال الله عز وجل, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, إذا ابتليته بحبيبتيه يريد عينيه ثم صبر عوضته الجنة. If I tried him and tested him, meaning the son of Adam, if I tried him with his two beloved things, meaning his two eyes, then he remained patient, I would replace them with Jannah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this in a hadith Qudsi, that if I test my slave with the two things that are beloved to him, which are his eyes, because Bani Adam, they need their eyes. And their eyes are a great ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if Allah Jalla wa Ala tests them with their two beloved things and they remain patient, Allah would replace their eyes with Jannah. I mean, this will be their reward for it. So this hadith shows us that a person to have an illness in his eyes or to lose his eyes is a great trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a great trial. And for a person to remain patient is even greater, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace his eyes with Jannah. And there is no doubt that Jannah is greater than the eyes. And this is why we find it is from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He will always give Bani Adam better than what they do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no matter how we worship Allah jalla wa ala, we can strive our utmost, Allah jalla wa ala will give us things that we cannot imagine. And that's why when you look at the hadith of the last person to ever enter Jannah, imagine the last person, which means he is the most evil Muslim, the last person to enter Jannah. He's the most evil Muslim to enter Jannah. And he will be the last person, and when he enters Jannah, what does Allah Jalla wa Ala say to him? Would you like the whole dunya and everything it contains? He says, yes, I would. He said, then I will give you this and 10 times its amount. 10 times its amount. So then he says to Allah Jalla wa Ala, أَتَسْتَهْزِئُ مِنِّي وَأَنْتَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. That are you mocking me, like joking about me, insulting me like this, while you are the Lord of everything? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughs. And to show that this is how Allah Jalla wa Ala, his generosity is. That the worst Muslim ever to step foot on this earth, who was punished severely in the fire, and then he came crawling out of the fire, he will have 10 times the amount of this dunya. 10 times the amount. So imagine those who strive for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who try their utmost to worship Allah jalla wa ala and perfect their worshipping of Him. Imagine what they would have in Jannah, if the worst person is going to have 10 times this earth. Wouldn't it be sufficient for a person only to have a fraction of this earth? There are certain places, if you look on this earth, you'll think it is like Jannah. You see the most beautiful scenery, and you feel peace and contentment when you're there. So imagine how Jannah is, subhanAllah. This is not even a fraction of Jannah. This is not even comparable to Jannah. So Allah Jalla wa Ala always gives the believer more than he will give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So him remaining patient for these blessings that Allah Jalla wa Ala gave him and then took away from him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him with Jannah. So this also shows you the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam al-Bukhari, he mentions these narrations in this chapter because he's saying that these are the type of people that need to be visited if they are sick. This is the type of sickness that makes it a right upon this person that he is visited by the believers. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا خطاب قال حدثنا إسماعيل بن ثابت بن عجلان وإسحاق بن يزيد قال حدثنا إسماعيل قال حدثني ثابت بن القاسم عن أبي أمامة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الله عز وجل يا ابن آدم إذا أخذت كلمتيك وصبرت عند الصدمة واحتسبت لم أرد لك ثوابا دون الجنة.
هذا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned another hadith, which is a hadith Qudsi. He says, يَقُولُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, يَبْنَ آدَم, O son of Adam, إِذَا أَخَذْتُ كَرِيمَتَيْكَ, if I took these two honorable things to you, which are your eyes, فَصَبَرْتَ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ وَاحْتَسَبْتَ, and you were patient at the first instant, and you sought the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَمْ أَرْضَ لَكَ ثَوَابًا دُونَ الْجَنَّةِ, I will not be pleased with any reward for you which is less than Jannah. So which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the minimum reward He will give him for this jannah. That's the minimum reward. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be pleased with any reward which will be less than jannah for this person who was tested with his eyes, and immediately he was patient. And then he sought the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of these ahadith is very important to memorize. Even if you memorize it in English or paraphrase it, or you understand how the meaning of the hadith. So when someone is tested with an illness like this, you can encourage him with these ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because sometimes when people are tested with these calamities, that they lose their sight, they lose their vision, then they think that maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they have weak iman, that Allah jalla wa ala is punishing them, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't love them. So if you mention these sort of ahadith to them, it will bring them contentment, it will bring them peace, it will allow them to be patient. And this is from the great virtues of learning the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No.
باب أين يقرب العائل. حدثنا أحمد بن عيسى قال حدثني عبد الله بن واحد قال أخبرني عمرو بن عبد ربي بن سعيد قال حدثني بن حارث بن عمرو عن عبد الله بن الحارث عن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا عاد المريض جلس عند رأسه ثم قال سبع مرار أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيك وإن كان في أجله تأخير موقيا من وجعه.
Now Imam al-Bukhari, he says, بَابُ أَيْنَ يَقْعُدُ الْعَائِدِ, the chapter of where does the visitor sit. So the person who is visiting the sick, where does he sit with regards to the one who is sick? He mentions the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, who said, كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا عَادَ الْمَرِيضَ جَلَسَ عِنْدَ رَأْسِهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he would visit the sick, he would sit by his head. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he would visit the sick, he would sit by his head. ثُمَّ قَالَ سَبْعَ مِرَارٍ, and then he would say seven times, أَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ رَبَّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمَ أَنْ يَشْفِيَكَ, that I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest, the Lord of the great throne, that he cures you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would say this seven times. فَإِنْ كَانَ فِي أَجَلِهِ تَأْخِيرٌ عُوفِيَ مِنْ وَجَعِهِ, if this person had more life written for him, then he will be cured from his sickness. In this hadith now we find the etiquettes of sitting when visiting a person who is sick. And the Prophet ﷺ would sit beside his head. And this is only if there is a place for him to sit there, and there is no other place. Like if a person has a dedicated place for him to sit, then he sits in that place. But if he doesn't have anywhere specific for him to sit, then this is the best place for him to sit or to stand. And the reason behind this is mentioned by the ulama, is that when he speaks to him, it will be easier. Because a person who is unwell, it may not be that easy for him to speak. He might find difficulty in speaking. So when you are right beside his head, he doesn't have to raise his voice. Nor does he have to sit up to see you. He can turn his head and you are going to be sitting beside him. So it makes it easy for him to look at you. It makes him easy for him to hear you and communicate with you. And also the ulama mentioned, it makes it easy for you to do ruqya on him as well. So if the person is right next to you, he's right beside you, then you can recite and he will hear. You can touch his head and you can recite as well. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ would say, this dua, and this dua is like a ruqya. This dua is like a cure for him. Because Allah, he is saying, أَسْأَلُ اللَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ رَبَّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ أَنْ يَشْفِيكَ, I am asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the great throne, to cure you. And he mentioned this seven times, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So we also find that it is a sunnah of a person to say this dua when visiting the sick. As well as other du'as that we have also learnt, it is sunnah for a person to say this du'a. And Imam al-Bukhari later on in this kitab, not too far from here, he has a large number of chapters and ahadith where he mentions the different types of du'as of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for all of his affairs sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or for many of his affairs. And these are also very beneficial chapters that we will come to, so we can learn the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in various places. So when he's going to sleep, when he's waking up, when he's walking, when he's drinking, whatever he's doing sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he'll always remember Allah jalla wa ala. And one time, another time he'll remember Allah when he's visiting the sick. So he would make dua for the person, he would remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is how his life was revolving around the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا موسى قال حدثنا رفيع بن عبد الله قال ذهبت مع الحسن الى قتاده يعود فقعد عند راسه فساله ثم دعا له قال اللهم اشف قلبه واشف سقمه.
Now he mentioned the narration of Rabi' ibn Abdullah. He said, "Zahabtu ma' al-Hasan ila Qatadata na'uduhu." I went to Al-Hasan, and this Al-Hasan is Al-Basri. Ila Qatadata na'uduhu, to Qatada, to visit him. فَقَعَدَ عِنْدَ رَأْسِهِ. So Hasan, he sat beside his head. فَسَأَلَهُ ثُمَّ دَعَى لَهُ. So he asked him, he inquired about him. ثُمَّ دَعَى لَهُ, and then he made dua for him. And he said, "Allahumma shfi qalbahu wa shfi saqamahu." He said, "Oh Allah, cure his heart and cure his illness. Oh Allah, cure his heart and cure his illness." So he didn't limit it to just his illness, but he also made dua for his heart, which will be the root for all of his ibadah and his iman. So he said, "Oh Allah, cure his heart and cure his illness." So this is a dua from Al-Hasan Al-Basri, and there is no harm in a person making any dua, even if it is not found in the Quran and the Sunnah. As long as the dua is to Allah Jalla wa'ala and it fulfills the criteria of dua, it is permissible for a person to make any dua, but there is no doubt that the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is greater than the dua of those who are beneath him. No.
حدثنا عبد الله بن رجاء وحفص بن عمر قال حدثنا شعبة الحكم إبراهيم عن الأسود قال سألت عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها ما كان يصنع النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم في أهله فقالت كان يكون في مهنة أهله حضرة الصلاة خرج.
باب ما يعمل الرجل في بيته. The chapter of what a person does in his house, or what a man does in his house. So here Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala is mentioning some of the things that a man would do in his house. Because many people think that everything in the house is the role of the wife all of the chores of the house are for the wife to do. And the man has no role in the house to do at all. So Imam al-Bukhari mentions this chapter, and then a few chapters later he mentions the chapter of arrogance and pride. And wallahu a'lam, Imam al-Bukhari mentions this chapter to show how humble the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, and how there was no pride at all in his heart or his statements or his actions. So he said, "Babu ma ya'malu rajulu fi baytihi," the chapter of what a man he does in his house. Anil aswad, aswad, he said, "Sa'altu Aisha radiyallahu anha," that I asked Aisha radiyallahu anha, "Ma kana yasna'u an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi ahlihi." What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do with his family? فَقَالَ, she said, كَانَ يَكُونُ فِي مِهْنَةِ أَهْلِهِ فَإِذَا حَضَرَتِ الصَّلَاةُ خَرَجْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be helping and serving his family, and when the time of salah would come, he would leave. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would help his wives, and he would serve his wives. So if there were any needs that they would have, he would take care of them and he would do them sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِذَا حَضَرَتِ الصَّلَاةُ خَرَجْ. And when the time of salah would come, he would leave. So this shows you that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never put anything before the salah. So a person should help his family, he should help his children, he should help those who are around him, but he should not allow that to take precedence over the salah. The salah is the most important thing. So if the salah is called, he leaves for the masjid. When he comes home from salah, then he can continue doing what he was doing. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the best to his wives. As he said, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best of you are the best of you to his wives. وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِ. And I am the best of you to my wife. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best of you is the best of you to your wives. The best of you is the best of you to your families. And I am the best of you to my family. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that he is the first to implement this. And he fulfills their rights. And he gives them more than their rights. And he shows them love and he shows them compassion. and he gives them time. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shows that he is the best to his family sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih.
قال حدثنا مهدي بن ميمون الحاشم بن عروة عن أبيه قال سألت عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها ما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يعمل في بيته قالت يقصف نعله ويعمل ما يعمل الرجل في بيته.
Now from the hadith of Hisham ibn Urwa, who narrates from his father, who said, سَأَلْتُ عَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا, that I asked عَائِشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا, مَا كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَعْمَلُ فِي بَيْتِهِ. What did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم do in his house? قَالَتْ يَخْصِفُ نَعْلَهُ وَيَعْمَلُ مَا يَعْمَلُ الرَّجُلُ فِي بَيْتِهِ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would amend his sandals. So if his sandals were torn, then he would amend them himself صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he would stitch them. وَيَعْمَلُ مَا يَعْمَلُ الرَّجُلُ فِي بَيْتِهِ, and he will do all of the work that a man would do in his house. Now this hadith shows us that the custom of the person decides what the man does and what the woman does. Because he would do what the man does in his house. What does the man do in the house? In the custom of the Arabs, they would do particular chores and the women will do particular chores. In the custom of other people, the women are responsible for certain things in the house and the men are responsible for certain things in the house. So al-'ada muhakkama, this qa'ida in the sharia, that the custom of the people, it decides what is obligatory upon the people with regards to their rights and their roles in the house. So whatever it is from the custom of the men to do in the house, they would do. And whatever it is from the custom of the women to do in the house, they would do. But from this hadith we find how humble the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. That he would stitch his own sandals if they were torn. But not only this, it shows us that if his sandals were torn, he would not ask for a new pair. And he wouldn't go out and buy a new pair. But he would amend that which is broken if he is able to amend it. If something is torn, he will amend it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this shows us the difference between the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and ourselves. People may argue and say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but maybe he couldn't afford another pair. There were sahaba out there that were dying to give him their garments. They were dying to give their things to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew that this dunya was only temporary. And yes, it is permissible to take from the delights of this world. And it is permissible to wear good clothes and have even good branded clothes, as long as a person does not waste his money and go into extravagance. But the Prophet ﷺ, he didn't have this dunya in front of him. When he was lying down on a straw mat and the prince were on his back, he said, Mali wa mali dunya, there's nothing to do with me in this world. His whole focus was on the hereafter, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So being the greatest of Bani Adam and the greatest of the creation of Allah Jalla wa Ala, he would wear torn clothes and torn sandals that he would amend himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this shows you subhanallah that it is not about the garments that we wear and the quality of the clothes that we have. Because if that was the case, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wouldn't have been that beloved in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala. It is about our iman and our actions and how humble we are in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So at tawadu', being humble, is from the great qualities of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we'll find inshaAllah ta'ala when we start the chapter of pride and arrogance, how dangerous pride is and how it destroys a person's dunya and his akhirah. And how dangerous arrogance is and how it could destroy a person's iman completely. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the complete opposite to this, and doing all of these chores in his house shows you how humble he was. He could have had any servant working for him. He could have commanded his wives to do his work. But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would do certain things himself. Because he never liked to ask the creation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He disliked asking people. And he would do things himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No.
Father rahimahullah ta'ala, haddathna Ishaq, qala akhbarana Abdullah ibn Walid, and Sufyan, and Hisham, and abihi qala sa'antu a'ishata ma kana nabiyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yasma'u fi bayti. Qala ma yasma'u ahadukum fi bayti yaqsifu na'a.
Al-Imam al-Bukhari, he emphasizes on this, he says, from the hadith of Hisham, who narrates from his father, سَأَلْتُ عَائِشَ مَا كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَصْنَعُ فِي بَيْتِهِ. He asked Aisha, what did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم do in his house? She said, مَا يَصْنَعُ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي بَيْتِهِ. Just like anything that you lot do in your house. يَخْصِفُ النَّعَلْ, he would amend his sandals, وَيَرْقَعُ الثَّوْبُ, and he would patch his garments, وَيَخِيطُ, and he would stitch. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these are from the practices of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى باب إذا أحب الرجل أخاه فليعلمه. حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد عن ثوب قال حدثني حبيب بن عبيد عن المقدام في معنه كذب وكان قد أدركه قال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إذا أحب أحدكم أخاه فليعلمه.
وهذا حديث 541.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا عبد الله حدثنا عبد الله قال حدثني معاوية بن صالح عن يحيى بن سعيد عن قيل لعائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها ماذا كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يعمل في بيته؟ قالت كان بشرا من البشر يفلي ثوبه ويحلب شاته.
Now Imam al-Bukhari, he further emphasizes on this and he mentions the hadith of Umrah. قيل لعائشة, it was said to عائشة رضي الله عنها, ما كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعمل في بيته. What did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم work in his house? قالت كان بشرا من البشر. He was a human being from the human beings, صلى الله عليه وسلم. يفلي ثوبه. He used to clean his garments from the insects that used to enter it. ويحلب شاته. And he used to milk his animals, صلى الله عليه وسلم. Looking at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like this, some of us think that he was like an angel that was sent down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the revelation was just given to him and he would sit to his companions all day and all night teaching them about Islam. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a human being. He was a human being sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would find insects in his garments, he would clean them sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would require milk, he would go to his animals and he would milk them himself sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would find that his garment is torn, he would patch it himself, he would stitch it. His sandals are torn, he would amend them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All of the work that is required from a man, something is broken in the house, he would fix it. There is need for food in the house, he would go out and purchase it. He would do everything that a human being needs to do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the messenger of Allah jalla wa ala, and the greatest man to step foot on this earth, and he was an example for all of us. This is the role of a man. A man has his role in society, a man has his role in the house. It is for him to fulfill his role. And if he does not fulfill his role, then there will be a problem in the house. If he does not fulfill his role, if he expects his wife, for example, to go out and purchase the milk or purchase the bread or purchase the food, there's going to be problems in the house. If he expects her to spend from her money and he doesn't want to spend from his to provide for her, there will be problems in the marriage. The man, the role of the man is his role. And he has to fulfill his role just like the role of the woman is her role and she has to fulfill her role. These are their roles in society, and in order for them to be able to live happily and comfortably with each other, they have to all fulfill their own roles. And this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد بن ثوب قال حدثني حبيب بن عبيد عن المقدام بن وعد كلب وكان قد أدركه قال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إذا أحب أحدكم أخاه فليعلمه أنه أحبه.
Now Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala begins a new section in this kitab. He says, بَابُ إِذَا أَحَبَّ الرَّجُلُ أَخَاهُ فَلْيُعْلِمْهُ. The chapter of if a man, he loves his brother, then let him inform him about this. If a person now, he loves another believer, then let him inform him of the love that he has for him. And this is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is something the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded in this hadith. Now before we speak about this hadith, I want to take a small time to speak about loving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Loving a Muslim for the sake of Allah jalla wa ala is a great form of ibadah. It is a great form of ibadah to love a believer for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you love him because he is a believer. You love him because he is submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You love him for the sake of Allah jalla wa ala. This is a great act of worship, and this is something that brings us close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are many ahadith. There are many ahadith that speak about this great virtue. We find in the Sunan of Abi Dawud, from the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ لَأُنَاسًا مَا هُمْ بِأَنْبِيَاءِ وَلَا شُهَدَاءِ. That indeed, from the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are people. They are not from the anbiya, they are not from the prophets, and they are not from the shuhada, they are not from the martyrs. يَغْبِطُهُمْ الْأَنْبِيَاءُ وَالشُّهَدَاءُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ بِمَكَانِهِمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. That the prophets and the martyrs will want what they have on Yawm al-Qiyamah because of the station that they have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So subhanAllah, look at the beginning of this hadith. that they are people from the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are not anbiya, they are not prophets, and they are not shuhada. But the prophets and the shuhada would want what they have on Yawm al-Qiyamah because of what they have received from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ They said, O Messenger of Allah, تُخْبِرُنَا مَنْ هُمْ Inform us, who are they? قَالَ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, هُمْ قَوْمٌ تَحَابُوا بِرُوحِ اللَّهِ عَلَى غَيْرِ أَرْحَامٍ بَيْنَهُمْ They are a people that loved each other for the sake of Allah, and there was no lineage between them. They are a people that loved each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there is no lineage between them. وَلَا أَمْوَال يَتَعَاطُونَهَا And there is no wealth that they are passing on with each other. Meaning that it is not because of a favor that they have done for each other that they love each other, or that they are giving each other wealth, or that they have a relationship, they are from their lineage and from their family. It is not from these reasons. But they only love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَوَاللَّهِ إِنَّ وُجُوهَهُمْ لَنُورِ Then the Prophet ﷺ said, By Allah, their face will be light. وَإِنَّهُمْ عَلَى نُورٍ And they are upon light. لَا يَخَافُونَ إِذَا خَافَ النَّاسِ They will not fear if the people fear. وَلَا يَحْزَنُونَ إِذَا حَزِنَ النَّاسِ And they will not be saddened if the people are sad. وَقَرَأَ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم recited this verse. أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ That indeed the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there will be no fear upon them and they will not be sad. Look at this great reward for loving someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That a believer loves him, and he only loves him because he is a believer. He loves him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not because he wants something from him, or he requires something from him, or he has received something from him. But the fact that he is a believer, he loves him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقُولُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say on Yawm al-Qiyamah, أَيْنَ الْمُتَحَابُّونَ بِجَلَالِي Where are those people that loved each other because of me? Where are those people that loved each other because of me? الْيَوْمَ أُضِلُّهُمْ فِي ظِلِّي يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلِّي He said, on this day, I will put them in my shade, the day when there will be no shade except for my shade. It shows now, the believers on that day, they will have this station in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah jalla wa ala will inquire about them, where are the people that loved each other for my sake? On this day, I will put them in my shade, a day when there will be no shade except for my shade. And we find also in the other hadith in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, and also in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned those people who will be under the shade of Allah jalla wa ala on yawm al-qiyamah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَرَجُلَانْ تَحَابَّا فِي اللَّهِ اِجْتَمَعَا عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقَا عَلَيْهِ That two people, they love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They joined together, they came together like this, and they parted when they were like this. They will be under the shade of Allah jalla wa ala on a day when there will be no shade except for Allah jalla wa ala shade. So this shows us how great this love is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on Yawm al-Qiyamah, every love will disappear. And every friendship will come to an end except for this love and this friendship. Every love will disappear on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And every friendship will come to an end except for this type of friendship that was built upon the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or built upon the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-akhilla yawma idhin ba'duhum li ba'din adu. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, friends on that day, they will be enemies to each other. إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ Except for those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the greatest type of friendship. To love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And loving someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala has conditions. Like, what does it mean to actually love someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala? How do we know that we truly love someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala? There are a number of conditions that the ulama, they mentioned. For a person to be able to fulfill those who love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For amongst them, that this person comes to his aid. He comes to his help. He assists him when he is in need. This is a person that he is always there for his brother when he is in need. And the Prophet said, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُحِبَّ لِأَخِيهِ مَا يُحِبُّ لِنَفْسِهِ That none of you truly believes until he loves for his brother that which he loves for himself. He would want to be helped and protected and given security when he's in danger. The same way when you find your brothers or you find your sisters in danger, the believers are there, they stand up and they defend them. They defend their honor, they defend their lives, they defend their wealth. They defend them to the best of their ability. And this shows you that they truly love them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if they were in that calamity and they were in that problem and that situation, they would expect people to stand up for them as well. So just like you would love that for yourself, you would love that for your companions. And this is one of the conditions the ulama, they mentioned, to show that a person truly loves someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he will be there for him in the times of need. We also find that he fulfills his general rights as a believer. That if you love someone for the sake of Allah jalla wa ala, you will fulfill their general rights that they have over you as a believer. As the Prophet said, حَقُّ الْمُسْلِمِ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِ sit. That there are six rights a Muslim has upon another Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ was asked, وَمَا هُنَّ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. He was asked, what are they, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا لَقِيْتَهُ فَسَلِّمْ عَلَيْهِ. If you meet him, then say salam to him. So from his rights upon you is that you see a believer, you say assalamu alaikum. And subhanAllah, sometimes you see many believers, and your tongue will just keep saying assalamu alaikum, salamu alaikum. Imagine the reward you will have in the sight of Allah jalla wa ala. This is a sign that you truly love the believers, that you are wishing them salam. You are making dua for them. You are saying assalamu alaikum. So when you meet them, you say assalamu alaikum. وَإِذَا دَعَاكَ فَأَجِبْهُ. And if he invites you, then you answer. And you respond to his invitation. And some of the ulama say this is the walima. If he calls you to a walima and you are able to go, then you should go. وَإِذَا اسْتَنْصَحَكَ فَانْصَحْ لَهُ. And when he asks you for advice, you give him sincere advice. You give him the best possible advice that you could give him. وَإِذَا عَطِسَ فَحَمِدَ اللَّهَ فَشَمِّتْهُمْ. When he sneezes and he glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you respond. It's his right he has upon you. He says, Alhamdulillah, you say, Yarhamakullah. وَإِذَا مَرِضَ فَعُدْهُ. And when he is ill, you visit him. وَإِذَا مَاتَ فَاتَّبِعْهُ. And when he passes away, you follow his janazah. These are rights that the believers have. And for a person to fulfill these rights, shows that he loves him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also we find from the things that the ulama they mentioned, that a person is very gentle towards his brother. He's very gentle towards him. He's not harsh in his speech. When he sees him, he smiles. And this is how he builds his relationship. So the person feels security when he is around him, and he doesn't feel that he's going to be attacked or insulted. So this is one of the things, the qualities of a believer, the etiquette that he must have with his brothers, if he truly loves them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا تَحْقِرَنَّ مِنَ الْمَعْرُوفِ شَيْئًا وَلَوْ تَلْقَى أَخَاكَ بِوَجْهٍ طَلْقٍ. He said, do not belittle anything from the good deeds, even if you were to visit your brother and meet him with a smile on your face. So these are from the signs that show that you love him for the sake of Allah jalla wa'ala. That whenever he sees you are smiling. Whenever you look at him, you are smiling. Whenever he's around you, he feels security and comfort. This is how the believer is with his companions. This is how the believer is with his brothers. We also find that the believer, if you are sincere in this, and you truly love him for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, you will always help him when he is falling into haram. You would protect him when he is falling into haram, and you will encourage him with halal. So whenever he is doing a good deed, you will help him and assist him and encourage him. And whenever he is doing something haram, then you will protect him from this and you will prohibit him from this. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, لَيَنْصُرُ الرَّجُلُ أَخَاهُ ظَالِمًا أَوْ مَظْلُومًا. A Muslim, he should assist his brother, whether he is the oppressor or he is the one being oppressed. إِنْ كَانَ ظَالِمًا فَلْيَنْهَهُ فَإِنَّهُ لَهُ نَصْرٌ. If he is the oppressor, then prohibit him, because this is giving him victory. وَإِنْ كَانَ مَظْلُومًا فَلْيَنْصُرْهُ. And if he is being oppressed, then assist him and help him. So the believer is always there. If he's falling into haram, he takes him out of the haram. If he's doing something good, he encourages him to do more good. And he mentions good words to him to encourage him. So he's consistent with these good deeds. Another thing the scholars mention, and they say this is from the greatest of things, that a believer, to show that he truly loves his companion for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala, is that he makes dua for him in his absence. That he makes dua for him in his absence. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentions, دَعْوَةُ الْمُسْلِمْ لِأَخِيهِ بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ. That a person, a Muslim, to make dua for his brother in his absence, مُسْتَجَابَ, it is an accepted dua by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. عِنْدَ رَأْسِهِ مَلَكٌ مُوَكَّلٌ. That on his head there is an angel that has been sent. كُلَّمَا دَعَى لِأَخِيهِ بِخَيْرٍ. Every time he makes dua for his brother in good, قَالَ الْمَلَكَ الْمُوَكَّلْ بِهِ آمِين وَلَكَ بِمِثْلِ. Every time he makes dua for his brother, the angel says Ameen, and also to you too. So this is another, a great sign that you love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do we actually love each other that much? That when we are alone and no one sees us, or we are in sajda and we are making dua to Allah, Remember them in our du'as. This is a sign. This is why this is such a great ibadah to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Loving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because everyone claims to love each other for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. But do we love each other to the extent that we make du'a for them? When we raise our hands to make du'a, we remember this person. When we are in sajda, we remember this person. When we are in our tashahud, just before we say the salam, we remember this person. Is it that much? Do we love this person this much to fulfill that we actually love them for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala? This is how what we should ask ourselves, and this is what we should try and improve on, insha'Allah ta'ala. Another thing the scholars they mention is that a person should be very quick to give him an excuse if he falls into error. Nowadays a person, he falls into error, we begin to blame him, and we criticize him, and we do not make excuses for him. But if you love someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, you would know that this is not from his natural, this is not from his custom to disobey Allah Jalla wa'ala like this. Or this is not from his custom to make this mistake and do or transgress against you in this manner. So make an excuse for him. And this is a sign that you love him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the last thing the ulama they mention is that if a person loves someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, they would give them gifts. Just like the gifts were given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and just like he used to gift them back sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when gifts were given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as mentioned in the Sahih al-Bukhari, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقبل الهدية ويثيب عليها. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to accept gifts, and then he used to give people something back. So this shows you, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said تهادوا تحابوا, that give gifts and it will make you love one another. And this will be loving each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is how, these are ways that a believer can attain this ibadah and achieve this ibadah. That if you really want to love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then fulfill these things with that person. And if you truly love him for the sake of Allah jalla wa ala, and you are able to fulfill these conditions, and you are able to fulfill his rights, then you will have a position in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have a station in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The shuhada and the anbiya will look at you and they will love this thing that you have on yawm al-qiyamah. And they would want this thing that you have on yawm al-qiyamah. Because this is something so beloved to Allah jalla wa ala. And that Allah jalla wa ala raises a person because of it. So in this chapter, Imam al-Bukhari, he says, بَابُ إِذَا أَحَبَّ الرَّجُلُ أَخَاهُ فَلْيُعْلِمْهُ. The chapter of, if a man, he loves his brother, then let him inform him about this. And he mentions the hadith of al-Miqdam ibn Ma'li Karib, رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. He said, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا أحب أحدكم أخاه فليعلمه أنه أحبه. If any of you loves your brothers, loves your brother, then inform him that you love him. Then inform him that you love him. So we find from this hadith that if you inform someone that you love him, you are following the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and you are fulfilling this command of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. You can say, oh so and so, inni uhibbuka fillah. That, oh so and so, indeed, I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is fulfilling the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you love him for the sake of Allah, then inform him about this. Why should you inform him about this? Because this would draw his heart towards you as well. This will draw his heart, not only would you be following the sunnah, this will draw his heart towards you as well. And this shows you that it is permissible for a person to expose some of his good deeds if there is a benefit behind it. Loving someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala is a good deed. And then informing someone about this good deed, because it brings a maslaha, it brings a greater benefit, that it will draw his heart towards you. It will allow him, it will make him acknowledge that if you are going to advise him, you are only going to advise him from sincerity, because you love him for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Because if you love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would only advise him with good. You'd only advise him with sincerity. You'd only advise him with truthfulness. So this, it opens his heart to accepting things from you. So if you wanted to advise someone, maybe this is even a way that you could begin, oh so and so, I love you for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And I'm only telling you this because I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want to protect you from this. These are ways of advising, ways for a person to draw the heart of someone that he is speaking to. And this is from the traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to inform someone that you love them for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا يحيى بن بشر قال حدثنا طبيس قال حدثنا سفيان بن رباح عن أبي عبيد الله المجاهد قال لقيني رجل من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم فأخذ بمنكبي وورائي وقال ألا إني أحبك؟ قال أحبك الذي أحببتني له. فقال أولى أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال إذا أحب الرجل فليخبره أنه أحبه. ما أخبرتك؟ قال ثم أخذ يعرض علي الخطبة قال أما إن عندنا جارية أما إنها حوراء.
Now Imam al-Bukhari mentions the narration of Mujahid. He said, لَقِيَنِي رَجُلٌ مِّنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. A man from the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم met me. فَأَخَذَ بِمَنْكِبِي مِّنْ وَرَائِي. He held my shoulder from behind me. قَالَ أَمَا إِنِّي أُحِبُّكَ. He said, indeed, I love you. قَالَ So Mujahid, he responded, أَحَبَّكَ الَّذِي أَحْبَبْتَنِي لَهُ. He said, may the one that you love me for love you. And this is how we respond, as we find in the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can say ahab, how he said ahabbaka Allah alladhi ahbabtani la, or ahabbaka Allah, he said ahabbaka alladhi, or you can say from the sunnah as well, ahabbaka Allah alladhi ahbabtani fi. Faqala lawla anna rasulallahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam qala idha ahabba ar-rajulu ar-rajula falyukhbirhu annahu ahabbahu ma akhbartuk. He said if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hadn't said if a person loves another person then let him inform him that he loves him, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hadn't said this, then I wouldn't have said this to you. So it means that he would have hidden this love that he has for him. But because the Prophet ﷺ has told him to inform it, this is why he is informing him, to fulfill the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. قَالَ ثُمَّ أَخَذَ يَعْرِضُ عَلَيَّ الْخِطْبَةِ. After he mentioned this to him, then he gave him a proposal. قَالَ أَمَا إِنَّ عِنْدَنَا جَارِيَ أَمَا إِنَّهَا عَوْرَى. He said that we have a young girl that if you want to marry, but she has a deficiency in one of her eyes. So he's mentioned that, he's even proposed, so it shows you the permissibility of proposing someone to, because people find in some culture they say it's something which is negative for a person to propose his daughter to someone, or someone from his family, a female member to propose. The man is the one who should come. And they find that it's a problem in a person's honor if he does this. But this is not from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. It was known in the time of the Prophet ﷺ that the father, they would look for the best person for their daughters, and then they would offer their daughter's hand to them. Just like what happened to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar, and then it was given to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he offered his daughter, or he offered someone in someone's hand in marriage to Mujahid, and then he mentioned a deficiency that this person had. And this shows you the permissibility of mentioning a deficiency at the time of proposals, just so the person, he knows what he's going to see, who he's going to see, and he knows what type of marriage he's going to go into. No. But the point of evidence from this hadith is to tell the person you love them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also how to reply to someone who says this to you. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا موسى قال حدثنا مبارك قال حدثنا ثابت عن أنس قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما تحابا رجلان إلا كان أقبلهما أشدهما ربا لصاحبه.
Now the author, he mentions the hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, who said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا تَحَابَ الرَّجُلَانِ إِلَّا كَانَ أَفْضَلُهُمَا أَشَدَّهُمَا حُبًّا لِصَاحِبِهِ. There are no two people who love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except the best of them is the one who loves the other one more. So there are no two people who love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except the best of them is the one who loves the other one more. To show how great this is in the sight of Allah Jalla wa'ala. That the more you love your companion for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, the better you are in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
إذا أحببت أخا فلا تماله فلا تماله ولا تشابه ولا تسأل عنه عسى أن توافي له عدوا فيخبرك بما ليس فيه ويفرق بينك وبينه.
Now he mentions باب إذا أحب رجلا فلا يماره ولا يسأل عنه. He said the chapter of if a person loves someone, then he shouldn't quarrel with him and he shouldn't ask others about him. And in this chapter, Imam Bukhari mentions how to preserve this love between the people now. So now you have loved someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. How do you preserve this love that you have for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He mentions that Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he used to say, إِذَا أَحْبَبْتَ أَخًا فَلَا تُمَارِهِ. If you love someone, then do not quarrel with him. And this is like quarreling with him without any benefit. So a person is just having a debate or discussion, and there's no fruits that are going to come out of this, and they're just trying to overcome the other person in this. This is going to destroy the mahabba, the love that you have for one another. وَلَا تُشَارِّهِ. And do not treat him badly. Do not treat him badly, because if you treat someone badly, what's going to happen? He's going to turn away from you. That love that you built and the bonds that you built, they're going to be broken. وَلَا تَسْأَلْ عَنْهُ. And do not ask other people about him. Like meaning now, you love someone for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, do not go around and ask people, so what do you think about this person? What do you think about this person? Why has the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us not to do this? Why does Mu'adh radiallahu anhu tell us not to do this? He said, فَعَسَىٰ أَن تُوَافِيَ لَهُ عَدُوًا فَيُخْبِرَكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ فِيهِ فَيُفَرِّقَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ. Maybe you will find and you will meet someone that dislikes him. And then he will tell you about things that are not in him, and this will separate between you and him. So maybe you'll bump into someone who dislikes him. You say, what do you think about this person? He says, this person's an evil person. He says these things and he does these things. You, before you asked him, you had love for him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now that you've inquired about him, and this person now was an enemy to him, he disliked him, he has told you things about him that weren't true, and it's made your heart turn away from him. So Imam Bukhari over here tells us that these are certain things that will destroy the bonds that we have with one another. So do not quarrel with him for no reason. Do not treat him with etiquettes that are not from Islam. And do not just ask everyone about him, because you may hear things about him that you dislike. And we'll just take this final hadith inshaAllah ta'ala, and then we'll stop for the salah.
إني أحبك لله فدخل جميعا في الجنة كان الذي أحب في الله أرفع درجة بحبه على الذي أحبه له.
Now Imam al-Bukhari concludes this chapter with a hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَخًا لِلَّهِ فِي اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Whoever loves his brother for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, in the path of Allah Jalla wa'ala, فَقَالَ إِنِّي أُحِبُّكَ لِلَّهِ. And he says that indeed I love you for the sake of Allah. فَدَخَلَ جَمِيعًا الْجَنَّةِ, that both of them enter Jannah. كَانَ الَّذِي أَحَبَّ فِي اللَّهِ أَرْفَعَ دَرَجَةً لِحُبِّهِ عَلَى الَّذِي أَحَبَّهُ لَهُ. That the one who loves for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, he will be higher in his state because of the love that he had. So he will be higher in his state. And this meaning has been preceded in the hadith 544, that he will be better than this person because of the love that he had. This hadith, the final hadith that Imam al-Bukhari mentioned in this chapter, it has Abdul Rahman in the chain, and he's Abdul Rahman ibn Ziyad al-Ifriqi, and he is da'if, so this hadith is da'if, but a similar meaning can be found in the hadith number 544.